Okay, well, welcome back, calculus. The good news, well, there's good news and bad news. The good news is we're out of the woods. We do not have to use the definition of a derivative anymore to do this long, arduous process. We get to use shortcuts, basic differentiation rules. And differentiation simply means I'm taking the process, it's a process of taking the derivative. So it's just a different word, if you haven't known that yet. The bad news is there's a lot to talk about, so this is gonna be a fairly long video, I think. Apologize for that right away. So let's get after it. So here is the constant rule. And there's some different symbolic nature to this. This is basically saying I am taking the derivative in terms of x. So the d over dx is I'm taking the derivative, that's the top, in terms of x, and that's the bottom. So this says I'm taking the derivative in terms of x of a constant or any real number. So it's just the derivative of a number. I have an example. I'm taking the derivative in terms of x of 6. And the rule says, well, it's just going to equal 0. Now you can memorize that or you can understand it. Remember that the derivative is going to give me one of two things. If it's a linear function, it's going to give me the derivative. I'm sorry, reverse that. If it's a linear function, it's going to give me the slope. Or the derivative is going to give me an equation that allows me to get the slope of the tangent lines. Well, all this is really saying is if I'm taking the derivative of a number where I'm getting 6, it's really y equals 6. Or f of x, we want to write it in functional notation. F of x equals 6, or what do you know about y equals 6, or f of x equaling 6? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It's a horizontal line through 6. Well, what's the slope of a horizontal line? It's 0. That's why the derivative of a constant is 0. Because all it's asking for is what is the slope of a flat line. This number can be anything, and it's still going to be a flat line. So again, you can memorize that or you can understand it. The derivative of a constant is asking what is the slope of a flat line. It's 0, okay? Not gonna spend a ton of time doing that because it's pretty much cut and dry. The derivative of a number is 0. So let's get into when it's not that simple. We have the power rule. It says if n is notice what n is the exponent here. So if n is a rational number, rational just simply means that it's something that can be put in fraction form. So if n can be put in fraction form, if n is a rational number, then the function is differentiable, meaning I can take the derivative. Here's the rule. So the derivative in terms of x to the nth power, is equal to n times x, n, and this would be kind of in parentheses here, x to the n minus 1. So notice what's really happening is we're just taking this n, we're multiplying it out front, and we're subtracting 1 from the exponent. It's pretty simple when it's written simplistically, but this one can get you in trouble, and I've given you some examples to show you how this rule can be used when you're thinking it's not there, it's not available. So let's look at one that's nice and easy. So there's the rule. The derivative in terms of x to the n, well, I have x to the ninth, so I have x to the n. In this case, n is 9, okay? All it says is I'm supposed to take the variable and bring it down. So I'm going to take the 9 and bring it down. So I'm going to get 9x to the n minus 1, which is 9 minus 1. Well, that is equal to 9x to the 8th power. There is the derivative of x to the 9th power, 9x to the 8th. And that's not the slope, but that would allow us to get the slope if we knew the value of x. Okay, so that's pretty simple. Take the exponent, multiply it down, subtract 1 away from it, and we get the answer. Okay, now That's the last example I'm going to give that's nice and simple, because I want to show you the ones that are not, so you can say, oh, it has a power rule and it was just kind of a hidden issue. Okay? So let's look at the next one. I have the derivative in terms of x of 1 over x to the fifth. Now this is not x to the n, not currently, but we've got to remember that we can write it that way. So this is really no different than the derivative in terms of x. And I can take this x to the fifth and bring it up. And if I bring it up, I have to assign a negative to that 5, right? X to the negative fifth in the denominator position brought up is x to the negative 5. And now I have this situation. I have x to the n. And remember what it said. All it said was n must be a rational number. Well, I can put negative 5 in fraction form, so it's rational. Or just apply the power rule. Let's take the negative 5, multiply it in front. X to the n minus 1. And that's negative 5x to the negative 6. And if you remember back to your algebra 2 days, we don't want to write anything to a negative exponent. We kind of want to clean that up. So this would really be negative 5 over x to the 6th power. And there it is. So we had a power rule that was hidden here, as long as we knew we could move that x to the 5th up and create x to the negative 5. Okay? So that's an example. Very common for someone to look at this and think the power rule is not there, but it is. All right, so what else can we do to hide the power rule? Well, let's turn it into a radical. And let's remind ourselves, this is a square root, which means there really was a 2 that lived right there. And there's, back in the day, I think in your algebra days, just make this an m and a x to the n, that this was really no different. And the exponent would have been in fraction form. So remember, we're supposed to put the root, which is an m on the bottom, and the exponent assigned to the x on top. So over here, we can say, well, this is really the derivative in terms of x, and it has a root of 2, so that goes on the bottom, and the cube is assigned on top. There it is. The square root of x cubed is x to the 3/2. Now we can apply this power rule. Before we couldn't. It wasn't in the right form. So now we can just say, all right, well, the power rule says take the exponent, multiply it down. And then take one away. Which is 3/2 x to the 1/2. Now, I can leave it that way, or I can put it back in radical form, which would have been 3 root x over 2. And depending on the class you're in, would depend on which one you're supposed to be using. This is 1.5 minus 1, there's your half. X to the 1/2 is the square root of x. Okay? So again, something that doesn't necessarily look like this, but we can apply some algebra properties and generate the power rule. Okay? Let's do one more of these. Okay, same thing. Try this on your own. Well, this is a cube root of x to the 4th. Well, the root's supposed to go in the denominator position. There's the 3, and the 4 goes on top. So I'm taking the derivative in terms of x to the 4/3. So let's just apply the power rule. 4/3 is brought down. X to the, and let's take one away. Now, I'm not going to write minus 1 here because I'm in fraction form. I might as well write minus 3/3 because that's the same as minus 1. And now we can see that this would have been 4/3 x, and this is 1/3. And we can put this back in radical form, which is the cube root of x. And there it is. Again, very hidden. A lot of times you'll get here and students are just gonna want it to be x squared, x to the third, something nice and pretty. But if there's a radical associated with it, you can still put it back in a rational, right? This is a rational number, 4/3 is a fraction, which means the power rule applies, okay? All right, so what's next? Now we've got what is called the constant multiple rule. This rule, I'm gonna show it to you, I've got a couple examples, but you can kind of survive without it, and I'll kind of show you how you could survive without it, but it doesn't hurt to know it. And again, what we have here is we have the derivative in terms of x of a constant number as being multiplied into a function. And all it's really saying is, I can take this number and I can bring it out front, which is what I did here. And then we can just take the derivative of the function and then multiply the c back in. So let's look at an example right here. Let's just say that I have 6 times x cubed. And I just want you to know that the 6 really represents the c, and the f of x represents the x to the third power. This is really 6 times a function, I mean, because x cubed is a function all by itself. So this is a number times a function. It's really all that was talking about. Now all the constant multiple rule says is we could just take this 6 and bring it out and multiply it times the derivative of the function by itself. Well, we just did the derivative of a power rule, so this would be bring the 3 down, take 1 away, and put them back together. 18x squared ultimately would have been the derivative of 6x to the third. Now this is why I said you can kind of survive without doing this, because if I would have just went back to the original problem of just saying, well, what if I wanted to do this? Doesn't the power rule say I can just take the 3 and bring it out front? Well, 3 times 6 is 18. I can take 1 away from the exponent, and I'm going to go straight there anyway. So it's not a requirement to take that 6 and bring it out front, because we know it's going to happen anyway, right? We're going to end up putting them back together. So, but it's the rule, and it's worth talking about. So let's see what you can do with that. Try to use the constant multiple rule. Okay, so we can see a constant is 6. Let's bring it out. And let's ask ourselves, well, what would the derivative of this be? Because that's really all it is, right? Take the 6 out front and just simply take the derivative in terms of x of the original function. And what do we got? We have 6 times the derivative, which is now a power rule, which is 4x cubed. Put them back together. And we have the answer. Okay. All right, let's look at this one. And again, this is more or less practice on just cleaning up our answer. Okay, same thing. I'm going to take the 7 and bring it out. It's a constant, and there's a function right here. So let's think about just taking the derivative of the function. Well, what do we got? I got 7 times. And now I'm taking the derivative of x to the negative 2, which is negative 2x. And again, I'm supposed to subtract 1. That's what the power rule says, n minus 1. Well, I subtract 1, I get negative 3. I can put this together and say, well, now I have a negative 14x to the negative 3 And remember, we don't want to leave an answer with a negative exponent, so let's move that back down. And there it is. Okay? And one last opportunity to do this with just a radical. Again, this is just practice. So let's take this, this 11 out front. In this case, when I write my derivative in terms of x, I'm going to fix this because I want a power rule. So I'm going to write this as x, and it is a cube. So there is the organization of your fraction. The root goes on the bottom, the 5 goes on top, so it is x to the 5/3. X to the 5/3 is the cube root of x to the 5th. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to look at this and I'm going to say, all right, cool beans. I'm going to take the derivative here, which is now 5/3. I'm going to take 1 away from the exponent. I'll show my work here, because I really am subtracting 3/3. I'm subtracting 1. And what am I getting? Oops. Let's put those together. Let's get 55/3 x. And what am I going to get here? I'm going to get 2/3. So I'll write that as an answer, or I'll put it back in radical form. See, that bottom is a cube root, and this is an x squared. So I'm going to, and it's positive, which means it's all on top. So I get 55 cube root of x squared over 3. And if you were looking in my calculus book, you would see that as an answer in the back of the book if you were checking. It rarely leaves the answer like that. Okay? All right, so last one where we're doing that, but again, and there are times, right? I said you can survive without this, but there are often times when this is a very applicable approach and you want to do that. You want to take that number out. And there's a lot of limit properties that also want you to do that. So it's not a bad idea to come to grips with that. Okay? All right. So I think this is the last thing. And we've got the sum of, difference rule. And all this is saying, I am taking the derivative in terms of x of something plus or minus something. Okay? And the rule says, if it's addition or subtraction, I can separate these two and take the derivative individually. Okay? So look, the derivative of something plus or minus something else is equal to the derivative of f of x plus or minus the derivative of g of x. I can separate these and individually take its derivative. Let's see what that looks like. Apparently I didn't fix my PowerPoint because that's supposed to be an or on all these, but I've been way too far into this video to stop, so there's my edit. All right, so this is what it says. I have the derivative in terms of x of 3x plus 2, and I can recognize that this is a function by itself, and I'm plus a totally different function by itself, which means I can separate these, okay? So this is what it looks like. Derivative in terms of x of 3x plus the derivative in terms of x of 2. We actually started this video with this problem. The derivative of a constant. Well, the derivative of a constant was 0. And the derivative of this linear function should be its slope. So let's look and see what we get here. So the derivative in terms of x of 3x, so if you followed the power rule, there would be a 1 right there. We'd multiply these down and take 1 away. 1 minus 1 is 0. Plus, derivative of a constant is 0. Well, what is x to the 0 power, or anything to the 0 power? Well, that's 1. So this is no different than 3 times 1 plus 0, which is 3. Now let's look back. If you use the definition of a derivative on this function, hopefully you'd recognize, oh, that's linear. And what's the slope of that linear equation? Well, it's 3, which is why the answer is 3. It's kind of a long process of getting there, but that's the reality, that this equation was simply y equals 3x plus 2. And it's really saying, when I take the derivative of that, what's the slope? Well, the slope's right there, which is why it's supportive right there, okay? So let's get something other than a linear equation. Let's get a little bit more interesting. So now I have the derivative of 4 functions. So it doesn't just have to be 2, it could be 20. If everything's separated by addition, subtraction, I could individually take their derivatives. Make sure I got them all. 5x cubed, 3x squared, 2x, 9. Okay, so let's individually take their derivatives. This is a power rule. 3 times 5, 15. Take 1 away, I get x squared. Minus 2 times 3, 6. Take 1 away, I get x to the first power. Don't need to write that, I'm just doing that for being a good little math teacher. This was x to the first power. 1 times 2 is 2. That is technically x to the take 1 away, x to the 0. So we know that's just going to be a 2. And minus the derivative of a number is minus 0. So to clean this up, we have 15 x squared minus 6x plus 2. You're going to get very good at this, by the way. You'll start to just do it here and see your 15x squared, 6x to the first power, 2, and you know that will always be a 0. So you'll start to, the easy ones will, you'll start doing them in your head. But please don't, I mean, show your work. Be a good student. I'm trying to be a good math teacher. Be a good student. Show your work, and all good things will happen. Okay, so let's turn this into something a little different. So now we've got a negative exponent here. Now we've talked about that. That's still a power rule. But let's address this as a summed, and again, I should keep writing it over there. The derivative in terms of x, 3x to the negative 2. Notice I'm not writing the 3 out because I said I can survive without knowing that. Well, I don't want to say you can survive without knowing it, but you can survive without using it. Plus the derivative in terms of x of 4x minus the derivative in terms of x of 12. And there's a couple things, right? I know the answer is 0 here because it's the derivative of a number. I also know that this is supposed to be 4, because it's technically the derivative of a linear equation, which is the slope, which is 4. This is the only one that's going to give me something other than something at face value I knew I would get anyway. So let's do this. So negative 2 times 3 is negative 6. X, take 1 away, negative 3. Plus, this is going to be 4x to the 0, which is 4. Minus 0, and let's just put this back, and you know, if I was mean, I'd make you get a common denominator, but for the sake of this, we're just going to leave that alone. Negative 6 over x cubed plus 4. Maybe I should be less lenient and think, well, if I turn this into something with a common denominator, we would have gotten that, okay, because that was over 1, common denominator is x cubed, you would have had to multiply that up. So, you saw that in the back of the book. Chances are you're going to see that answer, not that one. Okay? All right, I don't know. Did I give you another one? Let's find out. I did not. Okay, so there's the examples. Constant rule, derivative of a number is zero. We got the power rule, x to the n equals n to the x to the n minus one. And the sum and difference, so if it's separated by addition, subtraction, you can individually take the derivatives and then just put it back together. Okay, good job.